With reference to a text from the writings of the Apostle Paul, the Bible commentary says this: all your experiences are a source of blessings unto you, because as the grace of God enables you to overcome your difficulties, many of you are inspired to rise to higher levels of Christian life and to give thanks to God for so many mercies. We live in a day when in every phase of life we're trying to find new incentives. Missionary work, industrial activities, sales work, school work. Incentives seem to be of prime importance. As I've thought of the incentives, perhaps the greatest of all, not perhaps, but actually the greatest of all, is what the Lord said. He said, think not I am come into the world to bring peace on earth, but to bring division, to set the daughter against the mother, and so on. And the angel's announcement, peace on earth, to men of goodwill, as one interpretation has it. With that, these thoughts in mind, there are just a few things now in the brief minutes that I have to talk with you before this meeting should come to a close. I should like to introduce a few thoughts from inspired partly by what our own Dr. Bradford headed a little article that he'd written for the instructor. It was entitled, Doing the Right Thing for the Right Reasons. And then he talked about the various incentives on a national basis which had inspired men. In the Spartan world, with the Nazis, in Athens, China, and so on. And as I thought of that, I remembered what the prophet Joseph Smith was told. In the first visitation which he received, when speaking of the world in which he lived, he said, they draw near me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. As I put that opposite two other statements, I find meaning in that. That means that they were not doing the right things for the right reasons when they're merely drawing near with their lips, but their hearts were far from him. And one of the severest words the Master used all through his ministry was the word hypocrite. Woe unto you hypocrites, which I'm sure is described by this statement, they draw near me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And so I suppose I should say that I'm going to talk for a few minutes about hypocrites, past, present, and probably not future. May I complete that quotation from the Master? This people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Now let me give you one example from the scripture regarding the Master's statement. Matthew records him saying, one of the things where they were doing right things for wrong reasons. He said, moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites of sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. Now we have some counterparts of that. We have men in the political field, for example, who have announced how much tithing they paid the previous year as a sort of a political boon to their candidacy. Now that's a carefully checked matter, but he publicized for the purpose of gaining favor among church people who should be impressed by the amount and size and the faithfulness of his so-called tithing. We have the spectacle of certain politicians who, when they're going to church or to whatever denomination it may be, they notify the photographers and the press that they're going to church that morning, so they'll be published all over the country the fact that they have gone to church. That always sounds good to the Christian people. We have people who pray in private places and then publicize the fact that they prayed. We publicize ward teaching and sacrament meeting attendance for the sake of comparative statistics. And we sometimes, in some places, publicize convert baptisms to make a record. I fancy the Master, if he were among us, would say of all such, and I'm talking of members of the church who do things like this, "Moreover, when ye fast, when you pray, when you worship, when you pay tithing, when you do your ward teaching and sacrament meeting, when you baptize, be not as the hypocrites. Verily, if you publicize it and dramatize it, you've got your reward already." It's another way of saying it. Let me give you another example. The Master said, "Brother, how canst thou say to thy brother, 'Let me pull the mote out of thine own eye,' when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, cast out first out the beam of thine own eye, out of thine own eye, and then thou shalt see clearly to pull the mote that is in thy brother's eye." You can't tell me the Master didn't have a sense of humor when he said that. Here you've got a great big boulder in your own eye, and yet you're trying to pull a little tiny splinter out of your neighbor's eye. I remember after the 24th of July parade up in Salt Lake, I was sitting in a group of men with President McKay, and they were saying, "President McKay, didn't that worry you, the nudity of those girls that rode the floats? My, wasn't that a spectacle?" President McKay listened patiently, and he said, "Do you know I never noticed it? I thought it was a beautiful thing. I never noticed their nudity." And after the election, somebody said to him, "President McKay, doesn't it worry you that a Catholic has been elected president?" And do you know the president's reply? "You know, all I thought about on election day, wasn't it wonderful in this great country that everybody could go to the polls and vote for a Catholic or a Quaker just as they pleased and wouldn't have to worry about it?" You see how higher than these petty things by which we usually judge, instead of seeking to dig out the little sliver or little tiny speck in a neighbor's eye, he wasn't concerned about that. He was only concerned about his own reaction to these things. In the sixth beatitude, you remember it says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Now, there were a lot of people in the days of the Master who didn't accept him as the Son of God. There were some who said, "Oh, he's just the son of Joseph the carpenter." Others said, He's a prince of Beelzebub, or that means a son of the devil. And when he'd performed some of these miraculous things, they said he's a wine bibber, or meaning he's just been drinking strong wine. There were only a very few that could say, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Why couldn't everybody see him? When we sing, I wish I could have been with him then, when he took little babes in his arms, well, a lot of our people wouldn't have accepted him any more then than they can accept the doctrines that come from the teachers of righteousness inspired by that same Savior. When we can't accept those who represent him here, it wouldn't be a bit easier to accept the Master himself were he to appear. Again, I read from the commentary about that matter of pure in heart. It stands for man's inmost soul when we speak of heart. It is pure when it contains no admixture of other substance. Benevolence is pure when it contains nothing of self-seeking. Justice is pure when it contains nothing of partiality. Love is pure when it has no lust. A man's heart is pure when it loves only the good, when its motives are right, and when all its aspirations are after the noble and true. Purity is here not synonymous with chastity, but it includes it. See God, just as the liar does not understand truthfulness and does not recognize it when he encounters it, so the unholy person does not understand sanctity and cannot understand God. But those who cleanse their heart understand God in proportion to their purity. And one day they are cleansed from all sin and shall see him face to face. Well, be careful that we're not so concerned about picking the speck out of the neighbor's eye when we've got a great big two-by-four in our own. And again, the Master said, Thou hypocrite, doth not each one of you on the Sabbath day loose his ox from the stall and lead him away to the watering? And ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan hath bound, lo, these 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day? Criticizing because he'd performed a healing. Well, I remember a sister who came into my office from one of the foreign countries, and she was working in our storehouse up in Logan. She came storming into Brother Joseph F. Merrill and said, Why, Brother Merrill, they're distributing pork from the bishop's storehouse up there where I've been working, and it's summertime. And Brother Merrill very wisely said, Go in and talk that over with Brother Lee. So she came into me and repeated it to me, I being somewhere in the welfare program, and I said, why are you so much disturbed about that? Why, she said, the Lord said we shouldn't eat pork or meat in the summertime. And I said, oh, where did he say that? I haven't read that. Why, in the Word of Wisdom? I said, not in my Doctrine and Covenants, it doesn't say that. Will you open the Doctrine and Covenants and read me what you've just said? Well, she tried to justify what she'd said. I said, the trouble, in your interpretations, I read the 49th section of the Doctrine and Covenants. And I'm not sure what a famine is. We should eat meat sparingly, yes, the Lord counsels. But when you reach a hard and fast conclusion contrary to what the Lord said, be careful, be careful. I find some of our brethren who are engaged in some leadership position, and they justify their neglect of their family because they say they're engaged in the Lord's work. I said, say to them, my dear brother, do you realize the most important of the Lord's work is the work you'll do within the walls of your own home? That's the most important work of the Lord. Don't get your sense of values mixed up. I remember a woman who came into me heartbroken, her husband had said, my wife, when she married me, agreed to